This week on CrossFeed,
the Church of St. Mark Zuckerberg,
meditate the germs away,
concealed weapons the church,
are Mormons Southern Baptist zombies,
is abortion the Holocaust?
Hello, everybody. Welcome to CrossFeed Religion News. I'm Pastor Dale Critchley, pastor of Shepherd of the Ridge Lutheran Church in North Ridgeville, Ohio.
And I'm Dr. Jim Butler, pastor of St. Luke's Lutheran Church in Dedham, Massachusetts. It's been a long time, folks. It's good to be back. Dale and I have just been crazy busy with ministry. We were joking, it was easier back in our previous churches when nothing was going on in either one of them.
Yeah.
But these days, we've both got lots going on with ministry. It's hard to keep up. Hey, before we get started, we got to do a shout out to Woman Wonder 10 on YouTube, who has, we'll share some of her emails later on, but she is, must be our number one fan anymore. She has been watching our stuff and sending us all sorts of comments. And so I often wondered if we had any fans. We have one for sure. Yeah. So
that's cool. Yeah. No, I would say that I think there's treatment for that. So,
and it's Woman Wonder 10. I keep wanting to say Wonder Woman.
Yeah,
but that's my comic book side.
It's your DC
through.
Comic.
That's right. That's right. So, welcome. So yeah, welcome. It's good here. Well, you know, Wonder Woman plays bolts and bracelets and stuff. I wonder how she would do with concealed weapons in church. I'm pulling for the segue there.
Oh, man, you're just like flying right into the stories. You told Jim's had a long day today. All right. So this is interesting. This is actually a discussion that that I saw one of my Facebook friends posted a link to this. And so here's a question. Wisconsin has a new law allowing concealed weapons. And so the state's five bishops, Catholic bishops, issued a statement saying they won't mandate churches prohibit concealed weapons, but they want parishioners not to carry them into churches as a sign of reverence.
Hey, nothing says love thy neighbor like a Magnum 357. I'm looking at my son.
Yeah, I was gonna say, with all the army people you have in your family, you better get that right.
44 Magnum. Okay. Smith and Wesson 500. He's giving me all kinds of guns over here. Yeah. We're talking about the fact that in Wisconsin there's a concealed weapons law now. And the bishops are saying you shouldn't carry a handgun into church. It's not reverent. So we're just saying, man, can you imagine what it's like to pass the peace in that church? Let us pass the peace. All right, I got a Glock. I got a Smith & Wesson. Let's pass around.
I don't know. I'm thinking about your Baptist churches and that, where they've got amen, you know.
Hey, amen, and start shooting up the
spam.
I just don't know what that reference more than a Smith & Wesson myself. I just, you know, what was it? They also want pastors to consider that Catholics' teachings stress nonviolent conflict resolution. Wow.
Does that mean the pastor shouldn't be packing either?
I don't know, man. The packing pastor. And that Catholic churches have a long tradition of serving as sanctuaries for people fleeing violence. Well, that has nothing really to do with, I think, the concealed weapons ban. But that's, as of November 1st, All Saints Day, we're going to add a few more saints. We're carrying concealed weapons with us.
That's why All Souls Day is on November 2nd.
That's right. So...
So I don't know. What do you think about people having concealed weapons in your church?
Long as they don't bring them out during the sermon. I think this sermon's over with right now. Yeah. Okay.
Well, you know, when I first thought about it, you know, I thought, boy, you know, just don't preach on somebody's pet sin, you know. You sure you want to go there, Pastor?
You're meddling in my business.
Yeah.
But on a serious note, I mean, reality-wise, most people care for protection. You've got to go through a lot of training. They just don't hand these things out. And actually, people who are carrying concealed weapons generally have less problems than anybody else. Have there been issues where somebody has come into a church with a gun and just started?
Sure, there have.
Yeah. You know, hostage situations? I mean, it would end that hostage situation real quick.
But here's the thing. When you've had somebody come into a church and start shooting the place up, he wasn't carrying that weapon legally.
Right. No, I'm saying, no, if somebody did, came into the, start pulling off and say, I'm going, can you just see him come pulling some of them? I'm going to start shooting. And, you know, six more pistols come up, but him and guys go right dead.
Well, you know, I mean, as a
today,
on a related story, you know, we hear with schools, you hear about like Columbine and things like that. But there actually was a situation and unfortunately I don't have the details, but I remember reading about it, right around the same time where there was, sort of somebody tried to start something like that, and the principal had a gun and brought an end to it real quick. Oh, I'm gonna get in trouble because I don't have the details on it.
Yep.
So before you repeat the story to anybody else, make sure you double check it.
So I think it sounds kind of fun. It's fun myself. I you know, would I recommend it? I don't know. Just don't let me see it. I don't. But the idea is it's a concealed weapon. You're not supposed to see it.
Right.
So
yeah.
However, we take enough guns. Those guns, we can create a few Mormon zombies out there or something.
There you go. All right, so
I had a hard time even understanding this.
It was pretty all right. News was weak this week. All right, there just wasn't a lot to draw from. I generally, when I'm going through and I pull up a whole bunch of potential stories, and then I start kind of skimming over them. And if it doesn't look like one we'd use, then I close it out, and then once I've gone through, I see how many we have left, and then I narrow it down from there. Well, this time, I had narrowed it down to, I had cut everything out. I was just about to close this one, and then I realized, oh wait, I only have 5 tabs open. So, why not?
Well, I should have sent you a story. This one I saw that I thought might have been interesting to talk about, but I don't. I just thought this was just very poorly written.
And a little ignorant.
A lot ignorant, but that's beside the point.
First of all, this is in the Salt Lake Tribune. All right.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Yeah. So that's important to note.
Okay. Yeah, that might have something to do with it. Anyway, it's talking about a piece that was written on a blog by the First Baptist Church, Smithton in Bellhaven, which must be in Utah. And he pokes fun at Southern Baptists who think doctrinal correctness alone makes their denomination superior to other Christian groups. Well, first of all, reality-wise, I don't know if it makes them necessarily superior, but their view is that they're right. And, what else would you expect them to say?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Mormons think they're right, too.
But I mean, Lutherans think they're right, Christian too. Group thinks it's right.
Right. Why would you preach it if you didn't think it was right?
Why would you join a church that you don't think is the right one?
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, this guy's complaining. He says, they kicked a lot of people for not believing the right things. I'm not welcome in the SBC because what I believe. Well, guess what? You think you're superior to the SBC.
Uh-huh. You think you're right. Yeah.
Yeah, you think you're right and they're wrong. I mean, that's just one of the natures of when we have a viewpoint. I mean, one of the more, I'm going to call it kind of infamous writings in the history of the Missouri Synod was one called, you know, the Lutheran Church, the True Visible Church on Earth, in which, you know, the guy argued, and some people argued that he said that Lutherans were the only church. No, but the true visible church. In other words, Lutherans are the church with the right doctrine. They're better than the other church because we have the right teaching. That was what he argued. And when I was at Gordon-Conwell, I said, I think Lutherans are right in every point. And a couple of guys were shocked. I said, if I didn't believe that, would I be Lutheran? You know, I said, don't you think Presbyterians are right? And all the way, well, yeah, but I wouldn't say we have the whole truth. I said, but Lutherans are wrong, right? Well, if you put it that way, I guess so. Just, you know.
Be honest about it, you know. Right. It's the whole, we try to be so, you know, kind of multicultural and inclusive and, you know, and all that kind of stuff that, that's kind of what it comes down to is you don't want to tell anybody else they're wrong. Right. You know, I always say that if you, and you, most our longtime viewers have probably heard me say this too many times, but if two people disagree, at least on a point of fact, not a matter of opinion, at least one of them is wrong.
Right. Yeah. Oops. Because I used to tell the guys, I used to say, you know, you're wrong. And if you're honest about it, you think I'm wrong. I mean, that's why I'm Lutheran. That's why you're Presbyterian. I can deal with that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to me, tolerance is, I often say tolerance is the right for, you know, I let other people have the right to be wrong. It doesn't mean I agree with you. But also, a friend of mine was the, got his PhD at Harvard, and he was teaching some courses at Harvard at the time, and he had this one young woman who was Unitarian write her MDiv thesis. And he was like, with her, he's reading through it, and he's going, would you please take a position?
Well, yeah, that's the problem with Unitarians.
You're trying to, well, it's just that she had one. She just didn't really want to admit it. You know, argue your point. Don't sit there and, you know, try and, you know, be nice to everybody else. You know, acknowledge what they say, but stand up for your own position.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and stuff. And that was kind of interesting. Interestingly enough, she asked him for a recommendation as a hospital chaplain.
Okay.
He gave her one, but he said, I wouldn't want her to be my hospital chaplain, but, you know, hey, look what some hospitals are looking for. This is it.
Yeah.
But anyway, so he goes on and then he talks about Reverend Robert Jeffress. Now, we talked about him a couple weeks ago. Who, you know, said that Mormons are not Christian. Mormons are nice and moral, but not Christian. You know, they may act like Christians, they may look like and talk like, but they're not real Christians at all. They're different. And that's absolutely true. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, even a little bit later, he even admits the fact that they believe the wrong things about Jesus, God, and the Bible.
Right. So, yeah. Here's where the zombie analogy comes in.
Most Which frightening, I don't understand, but go ahead. Please right. explain it to me. I lost it.
Most frightening scene in any zombie movie is when the hero confronts a loved one like his mother, but it isn't his mother anymore. It's now a mindless monster that wants to eat him alive. And so with a sense of false horror, he quips, Mormons are trying to turn us into them. All right. And so... You know, with a zombie movie, you know, you have this person that looks like a loved one, but then all of a sudden you realize that it's not them anymore. And so, you know, the idea here would be that, well, you thought this person was a Southern Baptist, and he mentions Southern Baptists becoming Mormons. You thought this person was a Southern Baptist, and then all of a sudden, you realize when you hear them, you know, they talk about Jesus and God the Father, but then you realize they reject the Trinity or something like that. That, oh, I thought that you were my Christian brother. All right. But it turns out you're not. and you're trying to turn me into someone like you. So it's a I think it was like, oh, it's Halloween. Let's use a zombie analogy. You know,
I don't think he does it very well.
No, I've used zombie analogies in my sermons more than once. I did it better than that.
That's obviously your different generation. I've never done that. I'm going to have to sometime. But
I talked about how in Christ we have life, but so often we're more like the walking dead. We don't act like we have life.
The other thing he says is I did really just, he says, the Southern Baptist image is so bad they're thinking of changing their name. Well, no, that's not accurate at all. They're thinking of changing the name because it sounds so regional.
Mm-hmm.
And just like, you know, we're the Lutheran Church of Missouri Synod, and a lot of us think, you know, doesn't that sound rather Midwestern and parochial?
For one, you have people of a specific category of people, all right? They can't speak up for themselves. They have no sort of political clout, although arguably there are lots of people taking a stand for the unborn, the entire pro-life movement. Many of the ways that they are gotten rid of are pretty nasty. You know, if you look at the actual abortion process, they're experimented on. Specific beyond just being unborn, there are specific people groups that are targeted. For instance, Planned Parenthood, if you look at where their facilities are built, they tend to be in neighborhoods with a above average percentage of ethnic minorities, especially blacks.
Right. Well, that's and the abortion rate among blacks is very large. But you know what? I've heard the analogy. I've always questioned it, other than number, and maybe, you know, to make it for that. But and the reason is just simply, I think that there's Teresa call it, and they use the term an anti-abortion advocate. I really rather they'd say a pro-life advocate. But anyhow, she says, you know, it's simply put, neither the state nor the federal government require pregnant women to kill their unborn children, regardless of the woman's circumstances, the unborn children's condition. To employ the language of constitutional law, abortions are not state actions, unlike the imprisonment and killing of Jews by the Nazis.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, there is there is no racial or ethnic part to it. I mean, Jews were killed by the Jews because they were Jews, and so were gypsies, and so were gays, and so were other people.
By the Germans.
By the Germans, because they were not pure. That's not the case here.
Right. You know, and more than that, this is, I mean, there's sort of, I was reading a while back, a list of sort of arguing, you know, how to argue or, and it was specifically about arguing on the internet, but most of the rules apply to, say real life. And, excuse me, one of the sort of points was, as soon as you compare something with Hitler, you lose.
That's, yep.
I mean, really, you've taken the absolute most extreme analogy that you can, come up with instead of something that, because it generates such a visceral reaction in people that, the immediate response is, okay, no, it's not that bad.
Right. And for some reason, the Holocaust is, I don't know, the great evil. I mean, and not to pass that off and sound nonchalant about it, but on the other hand, you know, Stalin killed like 20 million people. Stalin, yeah. And Lenin, you know, I mean, they killed a whole lot of people too, but of their own people for a lot for other reasons, but you know, people don't always talk about that. So that's one thing. Oh, one thing that she brings up in this thing is he says, the success of the video and its popularity of argument raised a broader question of whether comparing legalized abortion to the Holocaust or to slavery, another widespread analogy, is logical and effective, legitimate, even if it is effective. Well, I've never come across anybody comparing abortion to slavery. What I have come across is people comparing Roe v. Wade to the Dred Scott decision, basically in both of them saying that something that is arguably human is not a person, according to the court.
I actually have heard abortion compared to slavery in the sense that the pregnant woman becomes a slave to the unborn child. And that even if you acknowledge this as a person, is that are you obligated to is that person's life your obligation?
See, I've never heard that argument before.
I have. It's an interesting argument. It was one that really made me think. I actually it was part of a Bible study that I did not too long ago. I mean that I wrote based on conversations that I'd had with people. So,
but I never heard that one. I think that the thing reason he's taking is that legalized abortion is compared to slavery. I've never heard that. I have heard Roe v. Wade compared to Dred Scott.
Yeah. In this case,
and
yeah.
Its reasoning.
Mm-hmm.
But I've never heard the other one at all. That somehow. And the other, you know, I get, yeah, like you said, you know, this one guy writes, I don't think that choosing to kill their unborn children is the answer, but choosing that answer does not make them the moral equivalent of Nazis.
Right. Yeah, you have to think about what is your analogy. I mean, all analogies break down, but you do have to think about the implications of your analogy. And, you know, given that it's let's just say extremely rare that a woman wants to get an abortion. You know, for most, it's, you know, I don't really want to do this, but I feel that I have to.
Well, I don't know. There was a guy. I wish I kept this article. I really do. It's one of those I kick myself. But it was a doctor who got out of the abortion business who had done it for a number of years. And he said the reason he did it was because of the purely selfish reasons that he heard. Now, he was out in Southern California, and so he dealt with a lot of people who were fairly wealthy, actually. And he said that the final excuse for him that said, I'm done with this, was a woman who came in and wanted an abortion because the next year she was supposed to go on a cruise, and she didn't want to have to be fat while she was on the cruise.
Yeah,
and he was like, "No, I can't be part of this stuff anymore. This is just the ultimate in selfishness and self-centeredness." I'm not saying that's for many women. I'm not saying it's for majority. I'm not saying I don't even know how much of a minority. But he said he heard that type of stuff all the time and couldn't put up with it anymore.
Well, you know,
I wish I had that article still to this day. But that was somewhere in the late 1980s. I read that.
I hear plenty of arguments pro-choice, pro-abortion, depending what term you want to use, advocates. For the sake of dialogue, we'll say pro-choice, that have used career as a reason. That say a woman should have the right to pursue her career, and then choose, you know, when is the right time to have a baby based on her career position. And for me, that as a Christian, especially, but just as a human being, that seems like a really shallow reason. That I understand that career is really important to a lot of people, and certainly my career is important to me. You know, at the same time, really a career, for most people, comes down to money. And you can't use money as an issue when it comes to children, especially since, you know, there is such a thing as adoption. So if you say, I can't afford a kid, that's fine. There's people out there that will take that child so you don't have to kill that child.
Although the choice to give up a child is not easy either, you know?
No.
So let's move on to something. How about doing church on Facebook?
Okay. This was kind of interesting. It was, otherwise we wouldn't be doing it. Liberty University.
Jerry Falwell, you.
Yeah, they couldn't. All right. Their chapel was closed.
So the sanctuary of Lynchburg's Thomas Road Baptist Church, which they often pray, or their basketball arena, which is the place that they also use, Lynchburg also uses as a chapel, were both unavailable. Mm-hmm. So they couldn't get together for worship, and they didn't know what to do. So this guy and a bunch of other 20-somethings there at the school all decided to do church on Facebook. Although I'm not sure how they did it.
Yeah, they're kind of vague about it. Toward the end it talked about,
we've got to do something.
He's right.
You're right. We got to do something.
Absolutely.
You know what we got to do? Talk a party.
I did see something. Now I can't find it.
Not really talk about it. He says, we're inviting Liberty's 70,000 residential and online students to log onto Liberty's Facebook page, watch live with a close group of friends, and worship with us, to engage in the conversation, and enjoy some time discussing it together. But I guess they're doing a worship service that's going to be streamed over Facebook.
Right. Which is weird because Facebook doesn't have built-in streaming. They must be using something like Ustream or Livestream, which is what we use. And we stream our service for those who cannot be there for various reasons. Kids are, you know, homesick or you're homesick or shut-ins or, you know, anybody like that, so that they can make it, or the weather's bad and they're not comfortable coming out in bad weather, you know, or whatever other reason, another being, you have a baptism and you, have family members that want to be there but can't because they live too far away or something like that. We stream the service so that they can watch it live. And it's also safe so they can watch it later on too. As an alternative when their space is not available and as sort of as a better than nothing is essentially what they're doing here. I think, yeah, that's better than I could see, if there was enough interest, we had a really horrible snowstorm here we're going to have to cancel the service and that I don't know how much services ever get canceled here. But when I was in Iowa, there were a few times that we had to cancel services. Well, if I could still do the service, use recorded music so that the organist wouldn't have to come in. I could still do the service and stream it, and as long as it was set up so that wherever you could see both the altar and the pulpit and the lectern, you know, we'd be good to go. I could do the whole service and everybody could just watch online. So, or at least those who are internet connected. In this case, he's got 20-somethings. So, I'd probably shorten the service up a little bit, responsive readings would be kind of tricky.
Yeah. So I'm just not sure how you would do it. It seems to me to be... But of course, you know, I don't want to insult in Baptists, but on a lot of Baptists where you get a lot of contemporary Christian music, a lot of the times people sit and watch the people on stage anyway.
Right, yeah.
Instead of getting involved in singing. So maybe, you know, because it seems to me you're going to have very little participation. It's going to be very one way.
Right, right. Yeah, so we encourage people to use, because we use livestream.com, they have a chat feature. And we encourage people to use that. We really haven't really had anybody use it. But we said, you know, if people want to sort of be talking about the service or whatever, and use it that way, that, you know, by all means do so. Today we had a big, all our preschool kids were there, and so we had quite a few extra people there. And, we had somebody from church she snapped a few pictures and, posted them up on Facebook before the service was done and stuff. And, you know, and I encourage people to do that just as a way to say, you know what, this is who I am on Sunday mornings. This is where I'm at. I'm excited about it, and I want all you out there, on Facebook or whatever, to know that this is an exciting thing, and to use it as a way to say, you know, I'm inviting you, to come and check it out. So, I know people have kind of mixed feelings about that. I've heard a lot of, you know, pro and con, kind of arguments on doing something like that. But, you know, as far as, of course, this is an experiment, as once was the light bulb in the airplane, the internet, and the iPhone. Okay. Well, he just listed off four successful experiments. You know, he doesn't list, you know, cold fusion or something.
Well, I was trying to think. He doesn't list the Apple Lisa.
Yeah. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. You know, actually, I even talked about that today. And the thing is, start off talking about for all of his successes, Steve Jobs had a lot of failures. And so, but he learned from
it. You preached on Steve Jobs?
Well, I started off talking about that. We always think of his successes, but reality, he failed, and he said that he learned a lot from his failures. His failures added to be his successes, that he had to be a failure to be a success, today is All Saints Day. We think all these great saints of God. We got it all together with God, people, but we have to understand they were actually all really sinners in their lives, and that, you know, we have to understand you have to be a sinner in order to be a saint, because the only kind of people God really wants are sinners.
Okay, that works.
So, you know,
that's funny. I just
the geeky side of mine came through.
Yeah, my last article, newsletter article / blog post was on learning from failure, but it wasn't on Steve Jobs though.
And then finally, let's end it, and then. Every once in a while, we come across these articles that says how much prayer helps somebody and things, and how much difference. And now it's that meditation improves people's lives.
Yeah. Yeah. We're not talking about meditating on scripture here. They're actually talking about Buddhist and yoga traditions. Mindfulness. Meditation can have benefits for health and performance, including improved immune function, reduced blood pressure, and enhanced cognitive function. I think that the thing that sort of confuses me is why they sound so surprised and they're trying to come up with scientific explanations for this. Like, if you use meditation, which a lot of it is just sort of relaxation techniques, to get your body into a more restful state, right? You're going to have less stress hormones running around in your body. And when you're under less stress, that is going to have a positive effect on your body. So I saw the article and I went, y'all. Has nothing to do with the sort of religious aspect of it. But again, it was a slow week for religious news.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's interesting that the only type of meditation they talk about is Eastern meditation. There is Christian meditation as well.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's the reality. I mean, the difference between Christian meditation and Eastern meditation is Eastern meditation, you try to empty yourself. Christian meditation, you try to fill yourself with Christ. And fill yourself by focusing on the Word. But in many respects, they can be the same thing. Because you do try to, you know, slow down your mind. You try to slow down your body, slow down your life. And so you are going to reduce your blood pressure. You are going to think more clearly. You are going to, you know, the guy says, you know, you provide the big picture of arranging many findings like pieces of a mosaic. And you do. As your mind, you know, focuses on something. And the guy says, you know, the state of meditation may account for its effects, attention regulation, body awareness, emotion regulation, the sense of self. Together, these help us deal with the effects of stress. When I was dealing with a lot of stress about 10 years ago, I guess about 10 years ago, maybe longer now, I guess about 13, 14 years ago, 1998 that's what it was. And I was seeing a therapist about it and stuff because I was having trouble dealing with everything and keeping up. And he taught me to meditate, and he said, I think it would do you a lot of good. It'd help you to deal with the stress that you feel and the stress that you're under and the stuff that, you know, just gets you all wound up. And, so he was trying to teach me Eastern meditation techniques, and I started reading about Christian meditation. And I would like to say I meditate more often than I do. When Luther talks, you know, says, you know, if I don't pray for 3 hours a day, I don't know what I'm going to do. He really was talking about meditating. If you read his tract to Peter the Barber on how to pray, it's really Christian meditation is what he's teaching in that. As you take a little section of scripture and you think about it, and you ask questions about it, and you reflect on it.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Christian meditation is a wonderful, wonderful gift. The only problem is it takes a lot of time. And as pastors, that's often the one thing we don't have.
Yeah. Yeah, unfortunately. But at the same time, as pastors, it's so important that we do it.
But I used to have another pastor, and we would meet at a Catholic monastery. And they would give us a private room, two private rooms there, and we would meditate. But they wanted $30 for half a day, including ham sandwiches for lunch. And I thought, that is, you know, god-awful expensive for no more than we're getting out of it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, actually, that Peter the Barber technique, I actually taught that Friday night. We had our youth group had a lock-in, and I did a study on prayer. It's more of a presentation than a study. But just teaching the kids about prayer and how to pray. And, you know, we spent some time talking about posture and how, you know, folding your hands isn't in scripture, and, but it's okay to do and, you know, different things like that. But yeah, I actually went through Luther's steps that he gave to Peter the Barber. And I said, this isn't the only way, but this is one way that you can do it. And I kind of walked him through that, and it's actually really it's something that not too long ago Jim pointed out to me that I hadn't seen before, and it really changed the way I pray and the way I read scripture, and I think it's really given a much greater. I'm getting a lot more out of my Bible reading than I used to, and it's a lot more personal. I'm able to apply it better, and so it's good stuff. So, yeah, in fact, I encourage you, if you just, if you Google, Luther prayer, Peter the Barber or something like that, you'll find there's some churches out there that have the tract online. It's like a PDF or something like that. So it's good stuff.
Right. It's a wonderful thing, but it's Christian meditation. It's Christian meditation. And yes, it, you know, we, I think that a lot of these things have things in common. And again, that does kind of focus your mind and it helps you to be able to get out of yourself and slow down your body and focus on God. Even though, granted, there is a huge difference between Christian meditation and Eastern meditation, but I think in some of the places where they overlap, they both have physical benefits.
Sure.
So, okay, do you want to start talking about our friend Woman Wonder 10 and some of her emails that we've received?
Six. So she's posted a total of 6 comments on YouTube. So... all on different videos, which, wow.
I got more than that. I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Well, some of them were like edits.
Okay.
So I'm actually looking at the YouTube inbox right now. So, she's watching them out of order, but that's all right. Not that they follow any sort of progression or anything like that. Pretty disorganized. Okay. CrossFeed 205, the 9/11 10th anniversary. Okay. Got to see it all. Pretty cool most of the way. Love the point made at, unfortunately, she makes these points about, at 46 minutes, 43 seconds. Promise me you want to look up the Lutheran confessions and read them. Also, I'll look up the founders. Wish you would have spelled the first guy's name. Muhlenberg.
Muhlenberg. That's how you spell Muhlenberg. And the other guy was not Walker, as she says, but Walther. Walther.
Who just celebrated his 200th, well, whose 200th birthday was celebrated. He didn't celebrate it
recently, and Muhlenberg's 300th. But she goes on. I like the last lines. I've had a few million. I put you guys out there big time because we need more Lutheran time, especially here on YouTube. I'm sick of ignoramuses bashing our faith.
Yeah, she prefers ignoramuses that are defending the faith.
That's right. If you had a few million, just shove it our way. We'll make good use of it. I guarantee you.
Yeah, I'm sure. One way or another. Yeah. So. Okay. Next episode 204, Lies and Statistics. I get the idea that Hispanics are in a religious rut with Catholicism. Oh, we were talking about the number of Hispanics who are active Catholics. Mm-hmm. Not to bash Catholics, I'm not into that. God knows our doctrinal differences with them. Goes back to Luther's Reformation. But what I have seen or been exposed to concerning Hispanics, it seems like the problem could be religion in the current definition, that is, rituals and the like. A lot of churches, evangelical churches, talk about how they're not religious because their focus is on relationship, not on ritual. Maybe like going through the motions, good program so far. Hope there's a lot more of this kind of topics to come. Enjoying the new find. God bless. And then the episode 137, interview with the pastor, where we had Dr. Johnson on talking about the ELCA decision to ordain non-celibate gay and lesbian clergy. And... she says, good question, Pastor Butler, concerning the juxtaposition of this issue and the Lutheran confessions. So that was a great episode.
I think that was one of our best ever.
Yeah.
I really do.
Anytime we can have an episode where we have other people talking besides us, that's a sure sign of a good episode.
That's probably true. And then 149 viral video, story about passing out cool drinks to concert attendees that end with an extra point you made. Also, heaping burning coals. I'll give you an A for that. And then I can't remember the comment. She said, who said to be a Christian you have to be a Republican? Who said that? It seems to me Republicans are usually conservative, plain and simple. But these same people have to have been tactically coerced to keep their mouths shut. So the liberals have been given a pass, particularly in black churches, to publicly support Democrats, especially by the media. You know, I think people say that a lot of more conservative people want to say that. You are absolutely right. I think that I don't know if I feel comfortable using the term liberals, but definitely black churches. I know they've had presidential candidates visiting these black churches. And that seems to be perfectly okay.
Mm-hmm.
But then, you know, within the black community, the church has always been a center of the community and of the political life. I mean, think about how many you know, leaders within the black community have come out of churches.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. You know, it was the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. And even though I think he went a little bit wayward, Jesse Jackson started out as a pastor.
Yep. The Reverend Jesse Jackson. Well, I figured out it's six episodes that she commented on. There's more than one comment on some of the episodes. That's why it was just showing up weird in my YouTube inbox.
So, but we do appreciate all of your comments and everything.
Yeah. Oh, this one on the episode 141 says, I would think as Lutherans, particular Missouri Synod, you did not or would not promote Scientology. I don't have time to get on the computer much besides schoolwork. Anytime I do, I spend watching you guys. Yes, I've not seen this one yet and may not even have time to see the whole thing. But I may have seen two of your programs, and I like them. Not to assume, I hope that you are taking your words very seriously as you're speaking as Christian pastors. We don't promote Scientology. It's sort of bad science fiction. Put it this way, it's not a... It's not so much a religion as it is a money-making scheme for L. Ron Hubbard back when he was alive enough to take advantage of it. We've referred to it as the... Mormonism's the Battlestar Galactica religion. Battlefield Earth.
Right.
So it's... I mean... It's pretty bizarre. Anytime you've got the leader of a, say, before the religion starts, that a good way to make a lot of money is to start a religion. And then he starts a religion and he charges people, you know, there's no free will offering there. If you want to get yourself right, you've got to pay for all these things. I mean, it's like, wow, and people actually they go for that, you know. So I don't know.
Yep.
Oh, and then says with our last episode before this one, 208. The entire show is really good. Thank you. Keep it up. When I have time, this is the first thing or one of the first things that I get to when on the internet. I really enjoy this, and congrats to Pastor Dale for the beautiful baby girl. So, thank you. She's like, I actually have her sleeping on my arm right now as we do this. So,
right. So, we are both going to be gone next week. Dale and I both have other appointments we have to do, so we'll be back in 2 weeks.
Probably.
In the meantime, probably. But good Lord willing, the creek don't rise.
Yeah.
In the meantime, God watch over, bless, and keep you in everything.
Yeah. Thanks, everybody, for your patience. And these episodes haven't always gotten out. I've been a little bit behind on the editing and stuff like that. So I appreciate your patience on that. And just really love the comments. Thanks again to Woman Wonder 10 for her comments and for everybody else for watching. If you like it, share it. And definitely you can post comments if you're watching this on YouTube or one of the video sharing sites, or you can send us an email at podcasts@crossfeednews.com. And I also want to encourage people to pop over to the iTunes podcast directory and leave a review there. So thank you, everybody, for checking us out, and God bless you, and have a good night.